you are going to design a screw jack, you will find length of the screw may be more. That's why buckling consideration is very important. It's okay. Good afternoon, one and all. Welcome to the today's session on power screw buckling consideration. Okay, objective of the today's session. After this session, you will be able to design a screw jack or a column against the buckling consideration, and you will decide the short and long columns that we are going to discuss. Why buckling consideration is important? You know very well in some of the applications, I am not just going to talk about the column. You will find in many applications, many means, suppose in IC engine, you know the connecting rod, length of the connecting rod. It is also going to buckle. Here in case of screw jack, look at this figure, it's a screw jack. Here we will find this part is nothing but a screw. Again here you will find this part is a nut and this is the body part or a frame which is fitted with the nut by using set screw. Then here to rotate the screw handle is used or a Tommy bar. Then over which here this is the collar of the screw, over which there is a cup and cup gives support to this the load, and because of the load it becomes stationary and there is a collar friction. But the main interesting thing in buckling consideration, how much is the length of screw? Because of this double load W, what would happen? There may be possibility of lateral deflection of the screw. Remember this thing. That's why buckling consideration is very important. Again, what is happening to lift the load during this time? Support W, which is at, look at this figure. You will find, and when we are going to rotate the nut by using a Tommy bar, what would happen here? This screw gets or move in upward direction. And because of this air load, which acts on the cup, and because of that, there may be possibility of lateral deflection of the screw. And that is buckling. That's why buckling is a very important phenomena in case of screw. So while designing the screw, in the power screw or screw jack design, what you have to do? You have to find out the dimension of the cup. You have to find out the length of the handle or a Tommy bar. You are going to design this screw or a power screw. You are going to design this nut, then body part, or by using some empirical relation, you have to decide the body part dimensions. That means here in project 3, you are going to learn these things. But the one important concept or the concept we are going to discuss, buckling consideration, because that you have to take into consideration while designing the screw jack. Remember these things. Okay, the before what are the different criteria to take into account this consideration, when to consider the buckling, when not, we will discuss that. The before that, you should know, what do you mean by buckling. The actually what is happening, you know, the column. Generally, column, when it's a machine, column is a slender machine component, it's okay. But why slender? Its length is so large if you are going to compare with its width, depth, and diameter. That means, suppose this is the one of the column, and if its diameter or other, you know, the width, depth, whatever may be the cross section, accordingly, you can compare with the length. And if this length is large, that time you can say it's a column or it's a slender machine component. It's a slender machine component. And you will find such examples in case of piston rods in hydraulic or pneumatic cylinders, you know, the piston rods. Then push rods in case of valve mechanisms, then power screws in jacks and connecting rods in IC engine. All these are the examples of the column. That means while designing these components, what you have to do, you have to check against the buckling, whether it is going to buckle or not. So before defining what do you mean by buckling, there are two terms. One is the bulging, another one is the buckling. And you know very well, already you studied some part in strength of machine element. Look at this figure, it's a column. Length is more and this cross-section diameter may be less. That's why it's a column. When it is subjected to axial force from both the sides, what would happen? Here, the dimensions, look at this here at the portion. What is going to happen? dimensions of the column is going to increase at some section of the column. But when it is going to change? When this short member is subjected to axial force, and because of this axial force, compressive stresses are going to induce in the column. And if this compressive stresses reaches to the elastic limit of the material, reaches elastic, that means Hooke's law. When this compressive stresses reaches to the elastic limit of the material, that time you will find the bulging is going to occur in short member. Remember this thing. This is the one term. But our focus is on buckling. What do you mean by buckling? Look at this. This is the another, you know, the column. When it is subjected to axial force, what is going to happen? And when this length, look at this member, this length of this component is compared with its cross section is large, then it is subjected to axial compressive force. And because of this, axial force is going to act in this way. And what is going to happen? Here there is a lateral deflection. Look at this. This is the lateral deflection. So you can see it's a buckling. It is going to buckle. That means in design of screw jack or power screws in jacks, you will find screw is going to buckle in some of the application. Sometimes it may not buckle, but while designing, you have to check whether it is going to buckle or not. How to decide when it is going to buckle and when it is not going to buckle? That is a very important one. So what do you mean by buckling? The buckling occurs when length of component is large compared with the cross section. Look at this figure. Once again, I will show. In this figure, this length, look at this. This length is large compared with this cross section or its dimension or diameter. So you can say this component is going to buckle because of axial force which act on it. Axial force. You can see it's buckling. And in another word is the bulging, where compressive stress reaches the elastic limit. Remember these two terms. But this bulging is applicable to the short column and it is applicable to the long column. That means short column, no need to take into account the buckling criteria. No need to take into account the buckling criteria. Okay. Then next important point, and another term that we are going to use in buckling, that is slenderness ratio. What do you mean by slenderness ratio? You might have studied in strength of machine element, that is L by K, where L is the length of column, K is the radius of gyration of the cross section about its axis. And this L by K is the slenderness ratio. And this slenderness ratio also decides whether the buckling of the column occurs or not. How? Let us see. Now, what is going to happen? As I have told on earlier slide, when the length of the column is large and there is, because of the compressive force or axial compressive force, there is a lateral deflection. But what is going to happen? When to say actually buckling starts, when the load or compressive or axial compressive load which acts on the column and when it reaches to the magnitude at which buckling starts. Buckling means lateral deflection starts, and that magnitude of load, you can see it's a critical load. That load is known as a critical load. Remember what I am telling here. Axial compressive force at which buckling start is known as critical load. That means critical load plays important role in case of buckling consideration. That's why whether it is going to buckle or not, for that purpose, we have to determine the magnitude of critical load. Remember these things. And then second case here, and this buckling, if you are going to compare it with the short column, this buckling is a sudden, relatively large lateral deflection is going to occur in the column, and that's why there is no alarm or a time, and suddenly the component is going to buckle. Remember these things. That's why this, the concept that is buckling criteria is very important in case of design of screw jack. Now, how to decide the buckling of the column? Remember these things. Suppose column made of ductile material, maybe steel, alloy steel, plain carbon steel, ductile material. If its length is more than 8 times the lateral dimension, 8 times means, suppose this is the length, L is equal to 8D. I am going to say L is equal to 8D. D is the diameter. So you can say, and if it is made up of ductile material, so you can say buckling of the column is going to occur. Remember these things. And similarly, if column is made up of brittle material and whose length is more about 6 times the lateral dimension. So remember, when column is made up of, column means you can take the example in screw jack screw. Suppose made up of ductile material and whose length is more than 8 times the lateral dimension, you can say it is going to buckle. This is one concept. Second, if column is made up of brittle material whose length is more than 6 times the least lateral dimension, you can say it is going to buckle. That means column made up of ductile material whose length is less than 8 times the least lateral deflection, it is not going to buckle. Remember this thing. Column made up of brittle material whose length is less than the 6 times least lateral dimension, you can say it is not going to buckle. This is the condition whether you are going to decide whether it is going to buckle or not. Okay, this is the one approach by considering the material, whether ductile and brittle, and based on the length and lateral dimension, so you can decide whether it is going to buckle or not. Again, here second, this buckling, it is sudden. And because of that, total failure occurs of the screw or a column without any warning. Remember, it's like a brittle failure. That's why the care should be taken while designing such a components. And that's why here it's very important to find out the critical load which affects the slenderness ratio. Or you can say, just on earlier slide, while discussing the things I have told, the load at which buckling starts, it's a critical load. The important parameter which affects the critical load is the slenderness ratio. As I have mentioned, so here, remember one thing, what you have to decide, the call, whether it's ductile material, brittle material, and how much is the length with respect to lateral dimension, you can decide whether it is going to buckle or not. This is one approach. Second approach, another parameter affecting the critical load means load at which buckling starts is a critical load. But important parameter, that is slenderness ratio. That's why slenderness ratio, that you have to determine. And critical slenderness ratio is the another term that we are going to use. And you have to compare slenderness ratio and critical slenderness ratio. Based on that, you can decide whether to, how to find out the critical load. The slenderness ratio, as I have mentioned, is very important. L by K is the ratio, where L is the length of column or a screw, K is the radius of gyration. And how to find out the K? You know very well in theory of machining, K is equal to under root I by A, where I is the moment of inertia of the cross section, and A is the area of the screw cross section or a column cross section. Remember, the where K is equal to I by A, you can note down slenderness ratio is equal to L by K, is equal to where K is equal to under root I by K. Okay, this is the slenderness ratio. But how to use this slenderness ratio? I will explain here. How to decide the buckling here? When this slenderness ratio is less than 30, L by K is less than 30, you can check it. So you can say no need to consider the critical load in design. Just you have to consider axial compressive stress and you can design the component. But when this slenderness ratio for a column or a screw is greater than 30, that time such a columns or a screws are designed on the basis of critical load. That time you have to find out the critical load. Remember, the house slenderness ratio is useful. If slenderness ratio L by K is 30 or less than 30, you can say as usual procedure you can follow. What are the compressive stresses are going to induce, you can determine, and based on that you can design the column or a screw. But when slenderness ratio L by K is greater than 30, that time you have to design such a column or a screws based on critical load. Remember, now assume if slenderness ratio is greater than 30, that means you have to find out the critical load. This is one approach. Then next important thing here, how to decide the, there are two terms, short column and long column, and how to decide. So look at this. I have written one thing here. For short, you can do it opposite or vice versa. Long columns are those with slenderness ratio greater than 100 for ductile material. So when to say column is long? When slenderness ratio, you can note down, slenderness ratio is greater than 100 for a ductile material, it's a long column. And when it say greater than 80, you can say long column for cast iron. For a cast iron, slenderness ratio 80, remember. But short column, you can say, suppose for a ductile material, if slenderness ratio is less than 100, you can say it's a short column of ductile material. And short column of cast iron, if slenderness ratio, which is less than 80, you can say short column of a brittle material. Remember these things. And you can note down these points. It's very interesting. Now, you have decided long column and short column. You have decided slenderness ratio greater than 30. You have to go for a critical lead. That means here, criteria to decide the buckling, critical load plays important role. But to determine this critical load, there are many methods. But we are restricted to two methods, which are very, very important. And these two methods are used to calculate the critical load. One is the Johnson's equation, and second one is the Ilor's equation. Remember these things. That means to decide the buckling, to determine the critical load, one slenderness ratio is greater than 30 and column is long. So what you have to do? Even though I have mentioned here for short column, slenderness ratio is less than 100 for the ductile. The slenderness ratio less than 80 for the cast iron. But if slenderness ratio greater than 30, that means it's a column. And we have to design for critical load. Column may be short or column may be long. Remember. But how to find out the critical load? Critical loads, there are two methods. One is the Johnson's equation. Second one is the Ilor's equation. Remember thinking. Let us see how to use these methods in the buckling consideration. Then, as mentioned earlier, when slenderness ratio is less than 30, no need to design the column based on buckling consideration, remember. And when it is more than that, you can use this for the same. I have already discussed this slide. Okay, I will change this slide. Okay. Now, there are two methods. One is the Ilor's equation. Second one is the Johnson's equation. And these equations are used to find out the critical load. But again, question arises, when to use Ilor's equation and when to use Johnson's equation? Let us discuss this point. When to use Ilor's equation, when to use Johnson's equation? We know that this is the Ilor's equation. This is the Ilor's equation. N into pi square into U E into A upon L by 3. L by K is the slenderness ratio. What is N here? Look at this. N is the end fixity coefficient. Because here in screw, you will find which is related to end condition. At the top, some load is there. You can see the end, one end is fixed and on the other end is free. And here the nut in case of screw jack. That means N is the end fixity coefficient. It decides the end condition for the column or a screw. Then what is E? Is the modulus of elasticity. What is A? Is the area of cross section of the column or a screw. What is L by K? I have already mentioned. It's a slenderness ratio. And what is PCR? It's a critical load. Okay. Then another equation is the Johnson's equation. Here one term is added extra, that is SYT. Other terms are same. N, phi, E, L by K. Only SYT is the yield tensile or yield strength of the material, which is used for the column or the screw. This equation, you can note down this equation. This is the Johnson's equation. This is Ilor's equation. But question arises, when to use this equation? When to use this equation? Now, what I am going to do, you can make the arrangement here. This A, I am going to remove this A and you can find out P, C, R by A. Again, this A, I am going to take this side. You will get critical load by A and you will get this equation. And here you will get PCR by MA means this equation. Remember these things. Why I am doing this? Because to make the analysis simple one, we have to make the arrangement. And end flexibility coefficient, how to decide? If both ends are hinge for the column, you can see N is equal to 1. Both ends are peaks, N is equal to 4. One end is peaks, other end is hinge, 2. And one end is peaks and other end is pre 0.25. Why I have mark here red color, you know, the bracket. In screw jack, one end is fixed. One fixed means top where cup is fitted and other end is free. Other side, you know, the bottom side is free. That's why this is end fixity coefficient for a screw jack is equal to 0.25. In this case, we are going to consider one end is fixed and other end is free. Remember this, one end is free and other end is other end is free. Okay. Now, we have two options. One is the Euler's equation and second one is the Johnson's equation. But when to go for a Johnson's equation and when to go for a Euler's equation? All these are the equation I have written. Here, so you can make the arrangement. I have written this PCR by A. Suppose you can make here PCR by A. I am going to remove this A here. And here also you can make the arrangement PCR by A. I am going to remove this A. So you will get this is equation 1 and this is equation 2. So what you have to do? You can find out PCR by A ratio for the Euler's equation, PCR by ratio for Johnson's equation in terms of L by K. Other values, S, Y, T, N, Phi, that you have to put. How to put it? Suppose let us take the end fixity coefficient. Both ends are hinged. For both ends, you can substitute the values. Then these columns are made up of plain carbon steel 48, SYT 380 Newton per mm square, and modulus of elasticity 207000 Newton per mm square. You can substitute all these values in both the equation 1 and 2. And what you have to do? You have to find out here PCR by A is equal to something in terms of L by K. Something in terms of L by K. L by K is the ratio. Here also you can find out PCR by A in terms something in terms of L by K. Remember, why L by K? Again, what you have to do? You can now, I have taken here one plot for these values. It's plotted. Okay, it's available in data books and even though Vivendari's book also. So what you have to do? You can substitute the slenderness ratio 60 here for both the cases. Suppose I am going to PCR A in this L by K is equal to 60 and other values, how much is the value I will get? I will get 600 by using Johnson's equation. If PCR by A and I am going to use 60, I will get here, this is the Johnson curve, Euler's curve, where is Euler's curve? This curve, this is the Johnson, this is the Euler's curve. So, okay, you will get here this value. For Euler's 600 and for Johnson, you will get 300 here. That means similarly, if I am going to put L by K 80, I will get some values here, this value and this value. In this way, if I am going to substitute L by K is equal to more than 100, so what is going to happen? This Johnson's curve and Euler's curve, they are going to intersect and become tangent at point P. And where, if I am going to find out this PCR by A, this is 190. And PCR by A is nothing, load upon area. So just you can think it is equivalent to SYT. It is equivalent to SYT. Why I am explaining this graph? Because this graph decides when to use Euler's equation, when to use Johnson's equation. So look at this. This is the Johnson curve and this is the Euler's curve. Very interesting thing. If for a plain carbon steel, if I have taken SYT is equal to 380, and if remember what I am telling, give attention here. Slenderness ratio L by K is equal to 60. What is PCR by A? This is the Johnson's, this is the Euler's equation. For Euler's equation, it's 600. But what is the value of SYT as per the material used for the column or its screw? It's a 380. That means it's not possible to use this Euler's curve. Remember, similarly, if I am going to put, look at this here. If slenderness ratio, I will erase. You can look this. Which is this curve? This curve is the Johnson. If slenderness ratio is greater than 140, what is the magnitude of PCR by A? It goes down. That means it's zero and below that. It's not possible. That means if slenderness ratio is greater than 140, if 140, we can't use Johnson. We can't use Johnson equation because it gives a negative value. That means, what does it mean? It means for short column, when slenderness ratio is less than 60, we have to prepare Johnson equation. And if slenderness ratio is greater than 60, for a long column, we have to use Euler's equation. Remember, you can note down from this graph. When column is short, screw is short, Johnson equation is prepared. And when column is long, Euler's equation is prepared. I have explained why. If it's a short, you will get PCR is equal to 600. For this Ilor's curve, but it's not possible. And that's why Johnson curve or Johnson equation that you have to use for short column, remember. Similarly, Ilor's equation you should use for long column. That means by substituting this value, you will get the idea which equation is preferred. So therefore, based on this curve, I am going to make the statement, Ilor's equation is suitable for long column. You can write, when slenderness ratio is greater than 60. And Johnson equation is used for short column when slenderness ratio is less than 60. This is one, you know, the interpretation from this graph. I hope you got it. Now let us see, but how to find out the critical load? That is very important. And critical load calculation to decide buckling, we will discuss now. Now look at this. Once again, I will show you the earlier curve. You will find where this curve intersects as a, like a tangent, this Johnson and Ilor's. You will find at this point, when slenderness ratio is 100 and something, that time P by A is near about 190. P by A is near about 190. So you can say it is the midpoint between Johnson curve and the Ilor's curve. To decide short column or a long column, this is one aspect. And second aspect, where you will get the PCR by A, this ratio, PCR by A, 190. That means at this point, P, this PCR by A means here in this problem is 380. It is half of, if I am going to divide by 2, you will get 190. And you will get this value near about 190. That's why based on this graph, I am going to make the statement from the graph is, so at the borderline where these two curves intersects, the unit load PCR A by A is equal to half of the yield strength. Half of the means SYT by 2. SYT 380 by 2, 190. At 190, you will get the pit point. That PCR by A is equal to SYT by 2. Remember, from the graph, I have written this. And you can refer also. PCR by A is equal to SY by 2. And therefore, the, I am going to substitute the value of PCR by A in which equation? Ilor's equation. So look at this. The PCR by A is replaced by SYT by 2. Is equal to n into pi square by into e upon l by k square. And by using this expression, you know the SYT, you know the n-fixity coefficient, you know the modulus of elasticity, you can find out l by k, that is slenderness ratio. And this slenderness ratio I have highlighted is a critical slenderness ratio. It's a critical slenderness ratio. Remember, so what you have to do? It's okay, critical load decides. We have to find out the critical load. From the graph, SYT by 2, you will get for the PCR by A. This is for SYT by 2. And by using this expression, you can find out the L by K. And this L by K is the critical slenderness ratio. Now remember, this is one equation available with you. So what you have to do? In general, in first, for your column or a screw, you can find out L by K by using simple expression. K is equal to under root I by M. I will show it. One minute, please. It's a I by A. I by A. M is using term. Okay. I by A. Now, by using this expression, you can determine L by K. It's a critical slenderness ratio. That means by using simple equation L by K, K is equal to under root I by A. You can substitute, you will get this ratio. And then by using this equation, you can find out this L by K. And if this critical slenderness ratio or this actual L by K, remember what statement I am going to make now. When this actual slenderness ratio, this is L by K, is less than the critical slenderness ratio, means from this equation, so you can say it's a short column, and for a short column, you have to use a Johnson equation. And if this L by K is the slenderness ratio, actual, if it's more than the critical slenderness ratio obtained by this equation, you can say you have to use a Ilor's equation and treat it as a long column. So in general, for a long column, Ilor's equation, for short column, Johnson's equation, and actual slenderness ratio, if it's less then the critical slenderness, you can assume it's a short column and use Johnson equation. And if actual slenderness ratio is more than critical slenderness ratio, you can treat it as a long column and use Euler's equation. And by using this equation, you can find out the critical load. Remember, that means before finding out the critical load, two methods, Johnson and Euler's, but which one is suitable? That's why you have to find out the critical slenderness ratio. And critical slenderness ratio is greater than actual or less than actual. It decides whether you have to go for a Johnson's equation, whether you have to go for a Euler's equation. And by using this equation, you can find out critical load, maybe by using Johnson or maybe by Euler's, based on long or short column or short or long column. And once you have a critical load and you have a W which is acting on the screw or a column, you can take its ratio and find out the FOS. And this FOS, or this is the calculated FOS for the column. If it's this FOS, its calculated FOS is greater than the factor of safety for the given screw and column, you can say your design is safe against the buckling consideration. Otherwise, it is going to buckle. And what, suppose if it is going to buckle, what you have to do? You have to increase the lateral dimension. This is one. But how much? You can check it. Then second, even though it is going to buckle, you can change the material in this way. Even though you can change the, you know, the, but in screw, the self-locking is the requirement. You are going to use the form of thread to have a self-locking. That means all aspects that you have to take into account. And in this way, you can check for buckling consideration. I hope you got it. I have referred V. Vandari's book. Thank you. Thank you very much.